Alice, you've written an article on credit conditions. Now, in the wake of the financial crisis, we saw a sharp tightening in the availability of credit, which followed a period in the run-up to the crisis where it was much easier to borrow. Could you start by saying, what do we mean by credit conditions?
Credit conditions relate to the cost and ease with which households and companies can borrow. So if you went to your bank to apply for a mortgage or a personal loan, say, you'd care about the types of loans available to you, the interest rates charged on those loans, and any terms and conditions attached to the loans.
And your article focuses on the cost of credit to households and firms, so in particular the interest rates they face when they take out a loan.
That's right. A useful indicator of credit conditions is a credit spread. That's the difference between the loan rates facing households and firms and some measure of risk-free interest rates, such as bank rate, which is the policy rate set by the Bank of England. For example, this chart shows the interest rate charged for a 75% loan-to-value tracker mortgage in blue alongside bank rate in pink. The difference between them is the credit spread for this mortgage product. As you can see, the cost of credit was quite low relative to bank rate in the period before the financial crisis. In other words, credit spreads were fairly compressed. But as the financial crisis unfolded and bank rate was reduced from around 5% to 0.5%, the mortgage interest rate shown here fell by a much smaller amount. In other words, the credit spread widened as the cut in bank rate was not fully passed through to households and businesses.
Now, clearly this matters a lot for economic conditions because, all else equal, the higher the credit spread, the more costly it is for households and firms to borrow. And this in turn is going to push down on the aggregate levels of spending and investment in the economy.
Correct, and we've seen that starkly since the onset of the financial crisis in 2007.
In your article, you construct a summary measure of credit spreads. What's your general approach for doing that?
Well, ideally, we'd look at the difference between the cost of taking out a new loan and some measure of risk-free rates for each household and firm in the UK. In practice, we don't have data at this level of detail, and so we look at the loan rates facing different groups of households, such as mortgages or unsecured borrowers, and different sizes of firm. For each of these loan rates, we calculate the credit spread by subtracting a reference rate of the same maturity. And the article explains how we weight together these different types of credit spreads in order to form a summary measure of the credit spreads facing households and UK firms as a whole. This chart shows the summary measure of credit spreads. So the difference between the rates facing typical households or companies and risk-free rates. Note that it's shown relative to 2007 Q3, which is the point in the financial crisis when spreads started widening markedly.
Now, as well as affecting economic decisions today, the evolution of credit spreads going forward is likely to impact on the amount of aggregate spending and investment in the economy.
That's right, and the Monetary Policy Committee, that's the MPC, take account of the likely future path of credit conditions when they set monetary policy each month. The red diamonds in this chart show the MPC's central projection for the summary measure of credit spreads that were published in the May 2014 inflation report. As you can see, spreads were expected to narrow over the next 3 years, although they remain wider than they were at the beginning of the crisis.
So when you project forward a forecast for credit spreads, what are the main factors you need to consider?
Well, one main factor is what it costs banks to provide loans. This is likely to depend on conditions in the banking sector. For example, funding costs are likely to depend partly on investors' perceptions of the riskiness of bank debt, and we might expect this to remain higher than the level of risk priced in the period leading up to the financial crisis.
I see.
The cost of making loans will also depend on regulation and the amount of capital which banks are required to have. In addition, banks typically price in compensation for expected losses associated with making a loan, to account for the fact that some borrowers may be unable to repay in full. Banks will also need to account for operating costs and achieve a required return for shareholders. There's more detail on all of this in the article.
Excellent. Alice, thanks very much.